Okay, well, welcome to Painswick Rococo Garden. What I really want to do now is just to sort of take about 5 minutes of your time before you go into the garden to give you a little bit of background history. So hopefully as you walk around, it will mean more to you. But let me start off by introducing myself. My name is Paul Moir, and I'm actually director of the charitable trust that runs the garden here at Painswick. I do also have another small claim to fame, and that is that I'm loosely connected with the family that actually built the house and laid out the gardens in the 18th century. I will be very honest though and say it is a very loose connection, so please don't ask me to draw a family tree, because that would take all day, and we certainly don't want to do that. Anyway, the story itself all began back in the 1730s with a gentleman called Charles Hyatt. He was an attorney, he was also an MP, and he had a very fine house in Gloucester. But he suffered very badly from asthma, so he decided that he'd build himself a country house up on the hills of Painswick, where obviously the air was of much better quality. And he built Painswick House, which you can just see behind you there, and it was completed in 1735. And when he finished it, he actually called it Buenos Aires, for good air. There's no Spanish connection to the family at all. Now, unfortunately for Charles, it didn't do him any good, because he died 3 years after the property was finished. And the estate then passed to his eldest son, Benjamin. And it is Benjamin who actually laid out the gardens that you're going to see today, sometime during the 1740s. We don't know exactly when. But what we do know, and we are eternally grateful, was that in 1748, he commissioned a local artist called Thomas Robbins to paint the house and the gardens. Because without that painting, we would have absolutely no idea what the garden looked like in its original format. And the reason for that, it changed dramatically in the following 200 and 250 years. And by the time we'd got round to the 1970s, the garden had actually been completely abandoned. A wood had been planted over it. It was a wood that wasn't looked after at all. So there were brambles, nettles, old man's beard, you name it, we had it. You couldn't get into the grounds at all. So why was the decision taken then to restore the garden when really we just had this fine old mess down there? Well, what happened was that in the 1970s, today's garden historians discovered Thomas Robbins as an artist, because he hadn't just painted the garden here at Painswick, but many other gardens in the Midlands and the Southwest. And what these garden historians realised was that he was actually painting a style of garden that they hadn't appreciated existed. He was painting gardens from about 1720 to 1760, when English gardens were changing from being very formal to being very informal. So these garden historians rediscovered a period of English garden design. They weren't satisfied with that. They had to give it a name, and they decided to call the period the Rococo period. I'll explain why in a minute, because it's probably the hardest question we get asked by people who come here. I'll just finish the history of Painswick. Because what happened was, there was a big exhibition in London of all the Robbins paintings, and then people began to wonder if any of the gardens he had depicted on canvas could be restored back to how they were, which brought a couple of historians down to Painswick here. They hacked their way through the undergrowth, and they could see that we still had the bones of that original garden. So they came out and they said to Lord Dickinson, who was the then family owner, "What you have got here is historically very, very important, and you really must put it back to how it was." "Oh yes," he said, "how much?" "About £100,000, they said. Now, we're talking about the early 1980s. He had just taken early retirement, wanted a project to do in his twilight years, and thought, well, if I open the garden to the public, put a little bit of my own money into it, it sounds like a project that I should be able to do. And that is why in October 1984, the bulldozers came in. Very soon after he started, it dawned on him that garden historians know a lot about garden history, but nothing about garden economics. We've already spent more than £1 million on the garden and could quite easily spend the same amount again. But it does explain why in 1988 we set the garden up as a charitable trust, because by being a charitable trust, we could go and raise funds from bodies who wouldn't give to a private individual. The other huge benefit is that the trust has a 99-year lease on the grounds that are the Rococo Garden. And that was extremely important, because in 2000 the house was sold out of the family for the first time since it was built, and being no doubt at all that if we weren't protected by this charitable trust, the gardens would not now be open to the public. So it is vitally important that we have this long lease. So that brings you up to date on the history. Now let's go back to this thorny question on why did they call this period the Rococo period? What is a Rococo garden? The problem with the term is, if I say to people, what do you think Rococo means? Those who have any idea at all say, oh, isn't it that very finely, highly decorative ornamentation? You get on architecture and you get on furniture. And it is right, that is right. But really, and I think this is probably more the case in England than in Europe, Rococo was about a lot more than a particular design. And the best way to describe it is that this was a period in this country when there was a certain mood going through the land, where the upper middle classes were wanting to show off their wealth. And they were doing that by creating things very flamboyant, very frivolous. They were over the top. They were designed to surprise and shock rather than to be taken seriously. And the way that translated into the gardens, that they crammed lots of things into a relatively small area. And the gardens almost became a theatrical set into which you took your house guests into for a garden party. They were pleasure grounds more than anything else. But the period did fall out of fashion very quickly, and there were two reasons for that. Firstly, Capability Brown came along, and the English landscape garden literally swept away everything that came before. But secondly, but probably more importantly, people began to look down their noses at this style of garden as being a little bit tacky, a little bit nouveau riche, maybe something that we don't want attached to our fine country house. And there was a wonderful quote that was written in the magazine in 1753, which I'll paraphrase, where the author is probably not so much ridiculing the actual design of the garden, but more the people who were creating them. Because he describes one as all being about 2 acres, with a path that wound continually over itself, leading to nothing more than a hermitage and a pompous and gilded building consecrated to Venus, for no other purpose that he could see, apart from the fact that the squire could cavort in vulgar love with local orange wenches. Now, I think if my garden was described as such, I would probably change it quite quickly. So I hope that gives you a little bit of background and explains a little bit about what the Rococo is. Just to give you bearings, we've got a shop, we've got guides for sale in there as well. Tea room restaurant here. The loos are just up there, some of you already found on the left. And up beyond there is the plant nursery, which operates from here, which is run quite independently, but it's actually owned by a Chelsea garden designer. And this year he won a silver gilt because he did the RNIB garden up at Chelsea. So it's quite nice to have that attached to the garden as well. So unless you've got any questions, I will leave you to it. Okay, well, have a nice walk round.